What up, everyone, and welcome back to another episode of the NerdGen Report. I'm your host, Pablo, and joining me as always is Mr. Brian Schultz. What's going on, Brian?
How much going on, Pablo? Countdown is on. WandaVision.
Yeah.
1 week.
1 week. Listen, I don't watch no commercials. I don't want to hear anybody talking about it, giving me their theories. I'm done. I'm waiting for the thing to be here, and that's it. So next week, we're going to get that, and it's going to be an exciting first day of watching that. I can't wait.
Double helping, too. We did get that. They're giving us episodes 1 and 2 at the same time.
Wow. That's an hour of my time that I will be unreachable. Well, however long those two episodes are, how long are the episodes supposed to be?
That's a good question. I'm going to guess they're going to be some, I would say the betting odds would be 45 minutes, give or take. I don't think it's going to be as short as Mandalorian, but I don't think it's going to be a full hour like some of the other shows we see on there.
So yeah, those two shows are going to be occupying my time. And it's like, I want to watch it with my wife, but she has to, I need silence. I need to watch this. Ask me later, yo. Oh, here, new rock stars. They'll tell you everything you need to know. Next week, WandaVision. Loki, season 2 has been announced. And we haven't even gotten the first. And when is the first supposed to come out? Is at
May.
In May. Okay. Yeah. So this must be, and I will say this, for most people whom I've spoken to about Loki, it, in terms of ranking, in terms of how excited they are for the content that's going to be delivered on Disney Plus, it's low on their list.
I agree.
And I think I had a little bit higher than most, but it's low on most people's list. And already it's getting a season 2. And I don't know, what did you say about that? Because I know you're tired of Loki.
It better be good. I think that this news ties to another piece of news I know you're going to talk about, or at least another individual who's going to be in here. But I always follow Marvel when they seemingly find someone they really like working with. When Kevin Feige finds someone he really likes working with, that person shows up all over the universe. And we've talked about in the past the Russo brothers, right? Like everyone said, how are these guys going to go from small time TV comedy to big budget action? The minute they prove they could do it, all of a sudden they're doing the Avengers movies. Man. And it was, but one thing they had talked about was their writers, Christopher Marcus, Stephen McNeely. A little bit of a rocky start for them. I think we were writers on Thor the Dark World. Like that's kind of how they, but then they gave us Winter Soldier. Then they gave us Civil War. Then they wound up giving us Infinity War and Endgame. So you see the same writers carry through, and we'll talk about it in a bit, but you're seeing something similar here as it connects to Loki. So that's the, I'm just going and saying, look, if they're willing to do that, they must feel like they've got something better than expected, whatever their expectations were, on their hands.
Listen, and I think most people would agree that they trust a lot in what Kevin decides to do with these characters, right? He hasn't always hit a home run, but for the most part, you know, he's always either, you know, made not so great film or story or whatever, he okays, because he okays everything. He's the guy. He is the guy. I'm not gonna, I had a little thing I wanted to say, but I'm not gonna say it. I'll say it some other time. But Kevin is the guy. So Thor the Dark World wasn't that great. Captain Marvel 2, you know, another film that wasn't that great, but it still made bank because of the brand. And Kevin is in large part, you know, the reason for this. So I trust in his decision, and he has that, you know, the ability to recognize talent, man. He gave us the Russos. He gave us Robert Downey Jr. He was like, yes, this guy, you know, so he does a good job of bringing these stories and characters to life. So it must be good. So we'll see. let us know in the comment section in below. Has this piqued your interest more? Is it rising up in the ranks? I don't know. I'm probably not for you, Brian. I know that. But
there's only one. Let me say that. There's one scenario where this might, and it's that something to do with the Time Variance Authority tying back to the series of films requires them to have season two. There's something about that sequencing that we need to know. That's probably the one thing. But as for the character itself, as I said, I feel like Tom Hiddleston had one of the best arcs for sort of a villain, anti-hero type character start to finish. And in some ways, I just don't want to disturb that. And I feel like this show risks kind of going too far with his character.
So. It could be possible. And I think this might be the case that his character will fill in the holes for some of the rest of the films, right? He'll, because of where he's at and what he's doing, he'll either play a part or begin a sort of series of events that it comes from that, his meddling or whatever the case may be for future films or shows or whatever the case. So yeah, man, Loki season two, I'm looking forward to seeing Loki. So hopefully that's good enough to warrant us wanting another season, but we'll see. In Kevin, we trust. Christian Bale, Gorr the God Killer is confirmed. You know, and this is, we heard this months ago. Never really talked about it because perhaps we mentioned it, but I know that I've been listening to this rumor of him being, ever since he was announced, and him being in Thor, that Gorr the God Killer was going to be the villain for Christian Bale to bring to life. What are your thoughts on this, on Christian Bale and his ability to, you know, because the guy can play, he has a range. Come on, we cannot argue the man's abilities. What do you think his performance is going to be like?
Yeah, I think ever since he was announced and rumored to be in this cast, I've been fascinated because I feel like the bar for him to come back to the genre was so high after he was Bruce Wayne for three films. Mm-hmm. And really, he was Bruce Wayne, but you could tell by the end of Dark Knight Rises, he was kind of done. Like, he did not want to go forward and do, you know. So for him to re-engage as a villain, you know, in the MCU, it has had my interest since the beginning, because he doesn't do silly and he doesn't mail it in. And I don't think he does, you know, I think of a lot of Marvel villains as pretty simple and one note sometimes, which gets some of the movies not in trouble, but maybe takes away from what they could be. And that's just not his style. I just refuse to believe he would have taken a check to do a character that didn't have layers to it. And this is actually a character that does have layers. Like, so for people who don't know, you know, the moniker, you know, Gorr the God Killer, Gorr the God Butcher, comes about because he discovers that gods are real, but that they allow bad things to happen in the worlds that they govern, including the death of his own family. And that's what motivates him to dedicate his life to destroying godlike figures. So right there, you have a conflict. Right there, you have someone who says, wait a minute, he's motivated by something personal that you kind of sympathize with. Yeah. Like, why did you let that happen on your watch? So that makes me a little bit interested, right? It's a little bit of that Killmonger flavor of, you can sort of see where he's coming from and why he's angry. The second piece of this that I have to throw out there, I think it's a long shot, but just, it is in the comics, and they really are leaning on the Jason Aaron iteration of Thor, which is sort of Mighty Thor. And that's Taika Waititi has been very open about that. So Jason Aaron created this character, and he carries a special weapon. I think it's called the All Black Sword. It has a very long name that I'm not gonna get right. It's called the All Black Sword. But the All Black Sword is intertwined with one Galactus on multiple occasions in the comics. Now, I have no idea if they're gonna draw upon that.
I think,
but Galactus described this weapon as the weapon which created the first dawn from night, or some crazy thing. And like, there's a time jump where an old Thor fights Galactus with the sword. So I don't know, like, if that would be at all included in this story, but I just draw your attention that it is a linkage in the comics.
I think, and that's what it'll be, a linkage. I don't think they'll go too far into Thor fighting Galactus. I don't think we'll see that story, but it'll definitely link him to that sword. I think we'll most likely. Listen, in the beginning, for most, if you've been watching this show, you know that Thor Ragnarok wasn't one of my favorites.
No, I agree. I'm with you.
But let's see. This is sounding, based on your perception of Christian Bale, you know, this guy doesn't do stupid stuff, right? He's not, like, he wouldn't do Black Mass in Birds of Prey, you know? So it piques my interest a little more. And
and this character, so they used Hela obviously in the third one, and Cate Blanchett, you could tell, was just hamming it up and having a great, so it fit with the a little bit of the silly tone, I guess, that this character doesn't fit that idea. That's the other thing. Like, it's a little, it definitely is a more serious, tragic character. So when that's why it doesn't fit with, like, Natalie Portman telling us that this movie is really silly. Like, I don't know, it just, there's something else here. And so I'm with you. Like, I kind of give it the benefit of the doubt because of, you know, these actors coming back to this, that it's not just going to be a comedy fest.
Yeah. I'm betting there's going to be a lot of dope quotes from Christian Bale. Like after he kills these gods, and his reasoning and makes people understand why he's doing what he's doing, and people realizing, yo, this dude is crazy, but he's going to do it. This is going to be very interesting. It's piqued my interest. DC News. And I usually get a little bit, my spirit like comes down a little bit when I get into DC News sometimes. At some point it was up, and now it's a roller coaster with DC. Marvel is like, it's like Bitcoin. Snyder Cut. Now, every time he comes out with these news and these visuals that he puts out, man, to me, these visuals of Darkseid and Steppenwolf look like a game. Like a dope game. It doesn't look appealing to me. And I mean, it doesn't have to be appealing to everyone. You know, people may like it, whatever. People, you know, they're fans of Zack Snyder. I get it. But to me, I don't, this doesn't, like, oh snap, I can't wait to see it. And also these other things, I heard a crazy rumor that he filmed two versions of this. I don't know if you heard that. Did you hear
the
that?
Whole film?
Yeah. No, two endings or something. He filmed two versions of something in that film.
Okay. That's, I heard, possible. That. Directors do that. That's,
yeah.
Possible. Yeah.
You know, but you know where that can lead to. You know, if this movie sucks, are people going to be like, we want to, you know, it's like, ugh, enough. No, this is not, you go to dinner, I don't like this, bring me another steak. No. It's over after this.
I still don't believe that. I'm doubling down. I don't care what he says.
You still don't believe?
I still think, I think there's a chance. I still think there's a chance you see a sequel to this. Because I just think money talks and viewers talk. And I just think this is going to do big subs for them. And I think they're going to look at their library, and they're going to look at what's out there, and, you know, views can change. And I just think there's a non-zero chance you're getting a second part to this.
I'm going to make an analogy here. I think where we are at this Jerry Reinsdorf, Michael Jordan type joint with Michael
the
Jordan.
Last Dance.
Yeah, this is like, I don't care if this is the greatest thing, it's over. Right? I think we have that sort of situation where, you know, Walter Hamada doesn't just, that's it, it's over. It's over. I don't care how many subscribers we get. We got Gotham, we got stuff, we got Green Lantern coming. We don't need this. We need to look towards the future. And that is why I don't want this anymore. I'll see this because I want to see his vision. I wanted to see what he wanted to put out. Finally get to see it. after this, no mas. It's over. But then you get, there was a couple of other things that were mentioned, that he shot like two scenes with with Jared Leto. And did he shoot also Malina, what's his name?
Joe Manganiello.
Yes.
Yep.
He shot something with him as well, correct?
Yep.
So we might see, we're going to see that, right? And it's just a small scene. I don't know how, what it's going to bring to the table, right? So, hey, I don't know what you think, Brian, because I just want to see the stuff already. We got like, what, 2 months left? Just be quiet, I think. Give us some more visuals. Give us a dope trailer and just wait.
So a couple of points. One is, how much do you think your reaction to images of Darkseid and Steppenwolf now are colored by the fact that you already saw the original version of this movie and didn't like it? Like, if you hadn't seen anything Justice League movie related and you saw these images, would you think you'd feel any better about them?
I mean, I look at them and I'm like, it looks like concept art. It doesn't look, you know.
Gotcha. I got you.
So I'm not excited for it at all. Because at the end of the day, it's all about story. You can show me beautiful stuff for any time, but the substance is what I want, the depth.
My thing with this is like, I mean, I've talked about it before, but I think I discount anything Darkseid related, because everything we know about the storyline for this movie indicates that this whole film was a setup and a tease of Darkseid in part two.
Correct.
So I just think every image we get, the scene of him in the trailer, which is, we've seen a version of that scene in the theatrical version, it just was Steppenwolf instead of Darkseid. To me, Darkseid is peripheral to this movie. He's a presence. He's like, it's like Thanos from Avengers 1, but maybe not done in as sort of dramatic and tight a way.
Yeah.
So every time he teases it, I'm kind of like, it almost makes me feel worse, because I feel like I know I'm not getting the fully fleshed out version of that character. So then I focus on Steppenwolf and I'm like, well, to your point, that's all about story, because he's the villain in this movie. So I just need to believe that that character matters in a way that I don't think he really mattered in the film.
Yeah, I agree with you 100%, man.
But if I'm gonna borrow your analogy, for our sake as fans, let's hope it is game 6 of the 98 finals and it ends with the hand up. That's a long shot.
That's the best way Zack Snyder can go out. With a dope film, but that's it. It's over. Let's see. Let us know in the comment section below. Do you want to see a Justice League 2? Do you want this Snyderverse to continue? Let us know in the comment section below. I don't. In another saga, Ray Fisher says that, the investigation is over. According to WarnerMedia, they're done with this. And, you know, they've taken some remedial action towards whomever. Josh Whedon is supposedly no longer involved with Warner Brothers. I don't know what involvement they had in the first place. He was just hired to do a film, and that was that. Perhaps he had other projects with them, and they're not doing it anymore. Correct?
Didn't he have a Batwoman project? Wasn't that the film that he originally
Batwoman.
Yeah, it was something like that. Yeah, sorry, Batwoman's the TV show. Batgirl, that's right. That was supposed to be set up as a film, and maybe then was going to be a streaming property. That must be the other thing.
Okay, so they're no longer, they've parted ways. Ray Fisher claims that they both also parted ways with Geoff Johns. If you go, I'll leave a link in the description. According to that article and some other conversations that I've had, he's very much involved in Warner Media and the content that is to be created for DC on their platform, movies, CW. He's very much in comic books. He's very much involved. I don't know. After this, I don't know. I hope not to hear any more about this. Because even Warner Brothers wants to move on from this. Like, that's it. It's time to move on. There's nothing to do. There's no body to put in jail. There's nothing, you know? So after this, I hope, hopefully, and they've written him out of Flashpoint. You know, and again, Brian, I've always said it, and I think you've agreed that he was a great cyborg. But enough is enough, man. You ain't gonna call me crazy and tell me and say all these things about me and then expect me to give you my money. No, it's over for you too.
It's separating. I mean, like I said, I know nothing about Geoff Johns, the person, conduct as an executive. I have no comment to that, know nothing about it. What I do know is that he has been, to your point, you know, he's been, I mean, he was almost sort of a version of Kevin Feige before there was Kevin Feige, in the sense that he was involved way back when Smallville was on television. He was kind of one of the guiding hands writers for that show. And has, to your point, he's been all over sort of the CW television shows. He's had his hands in the movies, in the actual comics, which he's written a few of those. So I think just physically separating him from the franchise, from the organization, if that's something they wanted to do, would take some work, just given how layered it is. Whereas Whedon is, as you said, he was sort of a hired gun, you know, to help with one project, and then basically had one other that never got off the ground. That's a lot easier to cut ties. It does seem like, you know, that Walter Hamada is probably the other name on Ray Fisher's list, given the tweets that we've seen. So you know, if we're trying to figure out like what would have been justice in Ray Fisher's eyes, it probably would have included all three of them getting removed, and you know, he didn't get that. But you know, I mean the removal from the Flashpoint, you know, like you said, it's a shame, because I think, you know, hopefully, you know, I think that regardless of how Justice League Snyder Cut is as a whole, I think we're going to walk out of there feeling like Ray Fisher distinguished himself in the performance more so than what we saw in the theater. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, it's like, you know, Flashpoint is in development hell. And so like they can write out and add whoever they want at this point. There's really we have no idea what's going on with that. There's no loss to us to that. So you know, it's a bummer for him, but
Dare I say, if Ray Fisher is fantastic, do we get fanfare signups or petitions, the P word, to put him in the Flashpoint? Do we get that sort of situation where Warner Brothers has to again concede, which people are finding difficult to do these days? I don't know.
That's interesting.
Fans, I'm telling you, we got the Snyder Cut. You know, we got the Snyder Cut. Took a while, but we got it. And like you said, Flashpoint hasn't started. Nothing is set in stone with Flashpoint. So if they decide to go forward with that, is he great enough in this film? Which there is a great possibility of that. Do people chant, "We want Ray Fisher in the Flashpoint"? It could happen. Let us know what you think in the comment section below. That is a very interesting possibility.
I will say that. See this, and I will say this is the danger with it. It is a danger. It's both a blessing and a curse in some ways. When you give the people what they want with regard to one project, which is the Snyder Cut, it gives life to all of these other causes. So to your point, like, you know, could you imagine a scenario in the MCU where we'd be talking about a petition to bring back a displaced kid? No, we would brush that off as like, there's no chance, because they've got firm command of their properties and the people. Mm. But this, because they've allowed it, you know, we're asking, is Amber Heard going to be in Aquaman 2 because of the petition against her? We're asking, could Ray Fisher be resurrected because there might be one for him? Could David Ayer see his Suicide Squad come to... As I said, one of my conspiracy theories is that Zack Snyder is going to be responsible for a subgenre onto himself, which is this idea of resurrected unfinished projects and maybe the influence on casting. I kind of hope not, because I feel like on balance, it just sort of makes the waters muddied if you just sort of let fan, you know, sentiment in the moment dictate your decisions. But
yeah,
you might get some good, you know, you might get, you know, get, you'll get some bad, but
yeah,
the fact that we can even talk about that and be like, oh yeah, that might happen, is kind of says where we are with
yeah,
with the studio. Although part of me wants to, you would say they wrote Cyborg out of Flash. Is it too, can we write the Flash out of Flashpoint? Or
write Ezra Miller.
I was gonna say,
out of the Flashpoint.
Wally West? Can we bring Wally West in?
Get Ezra Miller out of there. Michael Keaton is Batman. To me, Brian, I think if I had to say who, because I haven't seen Robert Pattinson's Batman, and I think Robert Pattinson's Batman is going to be perhaps the best Batman we've seen on film. But for now, we haven't seen it, and for me, Michael Keaton is the best Batman I've seen. You know, obviously, when he was first announced as Batman, people were like, what? But then he turned out to be great. And that happens over and over again sometimes with other actors. And he is going to be in the Flashpoint. My hope is, too bad that, what's that dude's name? From the guy that they had rumored to be, and he was Batman, Thomas Wayne. He was his father in Batman vs. Superman. He's in, I wish
we could. Oh, Jeffrey Dean Morgan.
Yes. What a missed opportunity, man. For me, I love Michael Keaton, but Jeffrey Dean Morgan as the Batman, Thomas Wayne, what a missed opportunity. But, so we get Michael Keaton for the Flashpoint. There's been a lot of news about, oh, we're doing this and we're doing that. Oh, no, it's not like that. Could you elaborate a little bit on that, Brian?
I think it stems from I think it was the New York Times article where they referenced two, they were talking about the DC, with Walter Hamada was talking about the DC universe. With the
year.
Where they were headed. I think it was the same article. And there's a reference in there to, you know, like two Batman, or there being two Batman at the same time, which we've heard, right? The multiverse point of it is we can have the character in different versions. Mm-hmm. But it took on a life of its own because someone asked the author whether or not Michael Keaton was the second Batman being referred to in that article. And the author said yes. Mm-hmm. And I think people took that and ran with it as, oh, does that mean Michael Keaton Batman is really coming back? As in, he's not just in Flashpoint as sort of a time series, you know, side character, but they're actually going back to that version of the character. And then the author, I think, kind of backtracked and said, no, I didn't mean for it to be a sign that they've got Michael Keaton signed for a lot of other projects. It's just he's done work as Batman up to this point. But, you know, where there's a little smoke, there could be, you never know with stuff like that. You never know how these contracts are structured. So for, and the world we live in now, Michael Keaton might be signed for multiple appearances. So, you know, it's an interesting question.
Yeah. My hope with this is that we get Batman Beyond from this. That is the hope. That is the only thing that makes sense to me. To continue being Batman as the old Batman and getting Terry McGinnis up to speed as to what Batman is all about and what he needs to be. That would be perfect for him.
That Batman is also different enough from the classic Batman that you could run that at the same time as the regular one.
Of course, absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Much more so than, say, if they actually made Michael Keaton the Frank Miller version of Batman in Dark Knight Returns. That one I'd be a little more concerned about. Like, yeah. even if we said, hey, Zack Snyder's not directing that, which I know he said he wants to, but we just said we're going to do that story. Mm-hmm. I don't know that the Michael Keaton version fits the way Frank Miller wrote that Batman. But the one you're talking about, which is he's the mentor in the future to Terry McGinnis, that is actually a better fit.
That's interesting. Star Wars. When this was announced quite some time ago, was it last year that Kevin Feige was mentioned or tapped to or wanted to produce a Star Wars film? Wasn't it like a year ago?
Yeah, it had to have been close to around the time of Rise of Skywalker because Star Wars was hurting, and that was sort of almost felt like, you know, Kevin was like looking across the studio at me and saying, "I got this. I'm gonna come in and help you." That's what it felt like a little bit, yeah. To be honest.
He's already started the ball rolling.
Yeah,
he's hired his writer, Michael Waldron, who is involved in a lot of popular shows, one of them being, although I don't think he's written on a lot of the shows, he's just one of the writers and was praised for his contribution on that show. Is the animated show, what's the name of that show? I forget all the time.
Rick and Morty, that's right.
Yes.
But he's, as I said, so this is where I was making the point earlier. Mm-hmm. He is now a point guy for Marvel.
Yes.
And beyond that, right? So you got, he's doing Kevin Feige's Star Wars. He's doing Loki. He's the lead writer on Loki. He wrote Doctor Strange 2, Multiverse of Madness. So this guy is being given the keys to a lot inside the kingdom right now.
He's that talent that you see, like, this guy got it. Let's keep him around. Let's do this. Let's do that. Hey, when you got something like that from jump, young, That's a beautiful thing. That's a beautiful thing. That's a long career right there. Kevin has gotten the ball rolling on Star Wars. One thing that it pops into my head, and it's not a negative thought, but it worries me a little bit. How would you feel? If Star Wars, Kevin Feige's Star Wars, feels like a Marvel film to you?
Yeah, no, I agree with you. There's a couple of risks here. I think that's one of them. I think the tone of the MCU and the tone of great Star Wars are different, mm-hmm. and I wouldn't want to see them crossed. Mm-hmm. The other is just, you know, as you said, in Kevin we trust, but I mean, presumably he's human. So seeing him stretched across a universe that's gotten so much bigger relative to where we started, you hope there's no quality suffer, you know, no quality reduction because of that. But at some point it's almost inevitable. Like, you just can't be as close to 40 projects as you were to 4, you know, I assume he has people around him that we don't really know publicly. The deputy Kevin has not really emerged, right? That person is not visible to us yet, as like the other lieutenants who are really close to these projects who are helping the machine run, because the machine's huge at this point. Yeah. That's my only other concern, is like, he's, you know, why jeopardize what's really working to dabble in something that wasn't really working, but now actually kind of seems like that ship may have been righted without him.
Yeah.
Because of Favreau and Filoni. So
I don't know. It'll be interesting, man. It'll be interesting. I hope we still don't know what the movie's going to be about. Do you know?
They didn't even confirm it at Investor Day, because remember, they confirmed the Taika Waititi Star Wars film as untitled. They didn't mention the Kevin Feige Star Wars film, which I did think was interesting.
Idea, right?
So that feels like it's still like on the drawing board.
Yeah.
The writer, you know, a writer means at least there'll be an idea pitched to Kathleen Kennedy. That's what that means. So it's more than just a handshake at this point.
Yeah. Interesting. I wanted to, because that was our last topic, but there was one thing that popped into my head, and it was an article today that was written about Zack Snyder. And this is going to be my hell no. Oh. This is my hell no segment.
I know what you're talking about. Okay, yeah, go ahead.
Zack Snyder would love, if he had the opportunity, to do a movie for Marvel with, I believe, Elektra.
Elektra Lives Again, which was a Frank Miller story, in case you're wondering, because I mean, anything Frank Miller, Zach will direct.
Yeah. Listen, I don't want to do nowhere near. I don't want him across the street. No. No. Zack Snyder, I'm sorry, man. You are the... And I don't know if the relationship would work because of the type of person he is, right? And because he wants to do things his way, right? He's the one that's been given the reins to do what he wants. At Marvel, from based on what I've seen, and you can ask a few others, they don't let you do whatever you want. So that is something that, and even if they came into I don't know, man. I don't want, hell no. I don't want him near MCU, man. You had your chance to do something fantastic, and it didn't work out, despite what anybody says. This version of the DC universe is whack to me. It is just whack to me. So, when I read that, man, and I sent you the article, I don't know what you thought of it. I don't know if you feel the same way, but I don't want Zack near anything MCU.
I'm not worried about it. I mean, I think it's kind of a dream. I don't see it. But, although, the chuckle that crossed my mind was he's looking at the landscape and he's like, well, the Ben Affleck Daredevil and Jennifer Gardner Elektra, that's easy comps, man. That's I could get over that bar. But he kind of, the other thing too is like, if you ever, well, it's a weird movie, but if you ever seen like Sucker Punch,
which I never really saw.
It's a Zack Snyder movie where like it's sort of women who are held prisoner in like a mental institution, but then the story plays out in their imagination and they're kind of like superheroes and ninjas in their own minds against the jailers. Like those characters are actually Elektra-like a little bit. There's a little bit of a whiff of that in there. So he's already kind of done a little bit of that type of character. And that movie was not successful, but I'm not too worried about it.
I mean, especially saying in public with many people listening, F Marvel, are you kidding me? You'll never get that shot. Never get that shot.
Hey, I gotta throw one in here though, because we're on this general subject of directors and Marvel. So you and I on our Wonder Woman 84 podcast, we talked a little bit about, you know, Patty Jenkins and directing the third one. And then, you know, we get the news, they're fast tracking it and Patty's back and Gall's back. Mm-hmm. You've been following her. She's been really active on the podcast circuit, you know, promoting this film, but being really candid about her prior experiences. Where would you put odds she actually does end up directing this movie? I do not think it's a slam dunk. I'm doubling down on the take that there is a chance that when all is said and done, she winds up as only the writer on this film and maybe the producer, but she hands the keys to the director to somebody else.
Listen, I if you listen to this podcast, I said this movie doesn't get done. And then I still don't think this movie gets done with her at the head of this. If it gets done. If it even
gets very candid comments, right? Talking about the opening of the first one. Coming into conflict with the studio, has talked about the third act of the first one coming into conflict with the studio, has talked about her general history of felt like, and I actually think she's probably 100% right, which is she was hired as a female figurehead so that male studio heads could then kind of tell her what to do on set. Wow. I actually think that's probably 100% true. Not for Wonder Woman specifically, but in general in her career, I have no doubt she's encountered that. Mm-hmm. But And she's always been one to speak her mind, which is what we knew with Thor the Dark World when she was on board. And then she's like, no, you're not doing it the way I want to do it. I'm out. It just has this feel of she's going to be working on Rogue Squadron. And you figure that's going to be a pretty harmonious experience based upon how we know Disney likes to operate. And, you know, Star Wars has had some issues with this, but generally the directors have been given leeway, right? Ryan Johnson was given leeway, whether you like Last Jedi or not, he was given control. Yeah. So she's going to have this experience where she's at the controls and doesn't have a lot of interference on a big movie that's going to take up a lot of her time. And then she's got this other movie, which is this the finale to Wonder Woman, but with a studio that's always looking over the shoulder and always seemingly interfering and creating. To me, when those two things are next to each other, it has the feel of she's going to be like, why am I going to put myself through the aggravation? Why don't I just hand in the screenplay, find someone else to direct it, and I'm going to go focus on Star Wars. I think there's a real chance.
Yeah. Listen, I enjoy video editing. I love it. But when it becomes, when you're creating and then somebody comes over and is watching you and telling you to do this and do that, but and they don't know what the vision is in your head, or they don't have the feel for it the way you do, they're just looking at it and just automatically telling you that they don't like this, they don't like that, not even knowing what it means. You know, when it gets into that situation, what you love to do, you don't want to do with that around. And if that's going to be the case, then it's quite certainly a possibility that she doesn't do this film the way they're making it out to be that she's doing this film, you know? And it seems that's the case. It seems that's the case. And if that's the case, you know, Patty Jenkins has every right to be like, yo, I'm out, I'm doing this. But for whatever reason, you know, we have to fast track it. We'll fast track, we'll get it, and then, you know, get somebody else to do it. Because it's written, everything is set. Let's just, you know, it'll probably turn out to be that way. So, listen. Wonder Woman 84 wasn't well received. Everybody knows this. I'm pretty sure it hurts Patty to get that feedback from fans. For the most part, no, you know, it hasn't been well received, and it was possibly because of the drama that occurred on set with Warner Brothers. And it's like, yo, who wants to work under those conditions? Who wants to be creative under those conditions when you're doing something that's coming out of your mind? Somebody's always like, nah, nah, nah. And it's like, yo, dude, chill, you know? So it's a tough situation. So let's see how it turns out. But yeah. This has been, anyway, first, let us know what you think in the comment section below about that situation with Patty. And also let us know in the comment section below, how would you feel if Kevin Feige's Star Wars felt like a Marvel film and didn't feel like a Star Wars film? It may be good, but it doesn't feel that, you know, when you watch The Mandalorian, you're like, this is Star Wars, stop it. Right?
I mean, Guardians of the Galaxy is a great watch. It's not a Star Wars movie, even though it's set in space.
Yeah. So let us know what you think, man. One of the reasons why I like doing this show is because it offers this opportunity for us to escape the craziness that's happening around in the world. So for those of you who continue watching the show and listening to the show and giving us that like, because that like is very important to us. It doesn't cost you a thing. It means a lot to us, and I hope you guys continue to watch the show and listen to the show and share it with your friends. Brian, any last words?
My last word is a real quick anecdote. You talked about the love of video editing, and we don't talk about it as much, but you know, we talk about directors, talk about writers, but cinematography is a huge part of what you see stylistically when you watch a show. And I think we got a little exciting piece of news that the cinematographer who did HBO's Watchmen, which is 10 out of 10, he is the cinematographer on Moon Knight, which lets you know that show is going to look good.
Amazing. Amazing. Yes. Yes. Looking forward to seeing that. I've been looking forward to Moon Knight for a minute because we're going to get to see something special there, I think. I hope. Hopefully, Oscar Isaac gets his... He breaks through that resistance we were talking about in previous shows and just flies. Like Bitcoin, just keep going up. This has been the NerdGen Report. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. Be safe and continue watching this content, man, and escape for a minute and enjoy these moments. Have a good night, everyone.